Good evening, and welcome to tonight's Kenyon Review Fall Poetry from the Kenyon Review, featuring Linda Gregerson, Richie Hofmann, and Rajiv Mohabir in the conversation with Nicole Dutton. I'm Elizabeth Dark, Associate Director of Programs for the Kenyon Review, and we are delighted to have you with us this evening. Nicole will begin our program in a moment, but first I will tend to a couple of details to help guide you through your time with us. If you would like to access closed captioning for this evening, you may do so by clicking on the CC button at the bottom of your screen. And also, if at any point you experience technical difficulties, our Kenyon Review associates Ocean Wei and Stephanie Chang are keeping an eye on the chat and are ready to assist you if you want to private message them there. They will also be posting helpful links in the chat throughout the evening, so keep your eyes open for those. The chat will remain open during the reading for your encouraging comments to our readers. And following the reading and Nicole's conversation with our guests, we will take some time for questions, which you can ask indirectly by putting your question in the chat or directly by clicking on the raise hand emoji or simply writing, "I have a question," in the chat. We will call on you, at which point you can unmute yourself. And I will encourage you, as you're listening to these people read, if a question comes to mind, write it down then and there so you don't forget it when the Q&A time comes. As an audience member, we welcome you to keep your camera on during the reading to give our readers some friendly faces to look at, or you may turn it off if you're finishing up your dinner or moving around and you wish not to distract us with your surroundings. Regardless, please do keep yourself muted during the event. We will spotlight the person speaking, but you'll note that you have some viewing options to choose from in the top right corner of your screen. When we get to the Q&A portion of the evening, we will remove the reader spotlight, but you can continue in that view by selecting spotlight speaker on your end. And I believe that is all I have to share, so I will now pass it on to Kenyon Review's Editor-in-Chief, Nicole Therese Dutton.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth. Elizabeth is a mastermind behind organizing this event, so thank you for everything. I'm very, very excited to have this conversation and reading with three exceptional poets. I'm going to introduce Linda first, and then Linda's going to read briefly, and then Richie, and then Rajiv, and then, as Elizabeth said, we're going to have a little conversation, and then I'm hopeful that we can all talk. I see so many friends here, and I'm looking forward to hearing from you. So let me start by introducing Linda. This is a bio that's mostly from the Poetry Foundation. Linda Gregerson earned a BA from Oberlin College, an MA from Northwestern University, an MFA from the University of Iowa Writers Workshop, and a PhD from Stanford University. Her new book of poems, Canopy, is forthcoming from Houghton Mifflin Harcourt in the spring of 2022. She teaches at the University of Michigan, where she also directs the Helen Zell Writers Program. A Renaissance scholar, a classically trained actor, and a devotee of the sciences, Gregerson produces lyrical poems informed by her expansive reading that are inquisitive, unflinching, and tender. Please welcome Linda Gregerson.
Thank you, Nicole. I'm going to read three poems, and two are from my forthcoming book, I Have Bound Galleys, which are always fun to get. And the third will be a newer poem. If the cure for AIDS. If the cure for AIDS, said someone in that earlier pandemic, were a glass of clean water, we couldn't save half the people here. If half the workers at Tyson Meats come down with the virus, we still have a plan for protecting the owners from lawsuits. If the phone in the farmhouse rings when it's long past dark and the milk, if the tanks at the co-op are full, if milk dumped into the culvert makes you think of death. My neighbor drove to Lansing in his pickup. I expect you've seen the photos too. The state house floor, the rifles. He had just culled half his herd. And while we're casting about for ways to summon normal, I've been watching footage of the day-old chicks, the 116,000 buried alive It seems we can't afford the fee or can't afford the falling price of chicken. I'm mostly confused by the articles meant to explain. Look at the spill of them. Dump truck into the pre-dug ditch. The mewling yellow spill of them still in the down we find adorable. Redder, impassive skyscape, skittering bits of agitation on the body of the whole. The next poem is written in three sections, and the second and third section relate to a painting many of you may know by Hans Holbein, of the body of Christ entombed. The first section is improbable as it sounds, is actually quite based on fact. My daughter and her marvelous dog have been deployed a lot in the past year for wilderness airborne search and rescue in the state of Michigan. They hope to find people alive, and sometimes they find human remains instead. And this section is about the sort of wonders of how nature communicates with itself and the miracle of dog perception. When nothing but tree can be seen in the tree, though the dogs unmistakably indicate. When clearly the canopy calls to them and days have passed before you've even begun. When nothing in the undergrowth has prompted so much as a whimper, you must turn your thoughts to the other bank. Scent from a living body will be carried on the wind. Scent from a corpse in the river spreads like oil. But say the return to elements has started just beyond that rise. The body is cold. The scent, like a river, seeks lowest ground, becoming part of the river itself, which the trees in turn imbibe, and drawing upward, change to living green. The one you seek is now an exhalation, as the dogs, intelligent beyond our wildest reckoning, have told us, have been telling us. In Basel, on a panel made of limewood, emphatically unrisen, the body of Christ lies in its frame as in a coffin. Thwarted verticals, and strung along a fault line where the pigment in egg yolk old way meets the pigment in linseed new, the flesh breathes beauty as only that which is liable to perish can breathe. The green going black of face, of feet, a visible hand confirm, no going back to what you were. How is it the linen on which he lies so clearly discloses a palette of stone, and hence the catalogue title, Entomb, which means the coffin I've imagined, warmer framework, must be pity's crafted afterthought or argument, the holy this world begging to differ with all we've been taught to hope for. 1521, the heretic from Wittenberg refuses to recant, though the question has not yet turned to presence or real. Sit down at my table, my body, my blood, and I on your behalf will paint a picture. Note the gaping nostril, gaping mouth. The other mouth of the wound in his side, the cradle of the abdomen. You see how disproportionate I've made his length, the better to seal credulity. It's 1521. It is known, writes my informant, that the artist used a body retrieved from the Rhine, citation needed. And either the fish had not eaten the open eye, or Holbein in his studio restored it. Never elsewhere, says the limewood, never blind. Behold the nearer case for mystery. I'm here to praise. And the third poem, more recent and I hope more filled with hope, Thin Air. As I recall, the play was mediocre, late, low energy from one who ought to have honored the work of his better days in better form. We were bored. We were waiting to be released. When in one of those moves that throws the poor actors like meat on the fire, he must have written, starts to cry. And she did, and did not stop. And when the character beside her asked with faint disgust, just what do you think you're crying for? The question was fair, if cruel, because it lacked all preparation. It was cheating, we hadn't been made to care, on stony ground. And that's when it happened. And somehow that was why as well. The utterly improbable, 3 or 4 times in a lifetime thing we come here for, the God from a machine for whom we hope to be the congregants. Because, she said, still crying, I'm unhappy. And the moment was majestic. We were crying too, or I was, in the presence of the one true conjuration, which is something out of nothing, which is mother grief and loneliness on earth assuaged, confessedly premised on pure technique, which is why we call it make-believe.
Thank you so much, Linda. Our next poet to read is Richie Hofmann. Richie Hofmann's new book of poems, 100 Lovers, is forthcoming from Knopf in 2022. He is the author of Second Empire, and his poetry appears recently in The New Yorker, The New York Review of Books, in The Yale Review, and The Kenyon Review. He teaches at Stanford University. Please welcome Richie Hofmann.
Thank you, Nicole. And thank you, Linda and Rajiv and Elizabeth and everyone who came out this evening. I'll read 3 Kenyon Review poems. The first one, it's a poem of Vienna, but I actually wrote it in Gambier, the Vienna of Ohio. My first summer at Kenyon when I was fellow in Carl Phillips's workshop. It's called Sacred and Profane Love. Our overnight train was outpacing the countryside, the speed at which it moved, flattening the grass, while in our sleeper car, he jerked my shirt back up over my shoulders, and I bit the white cotton, the stiff blankets loosening, the shadows loosening, dawn outrunning the edges of the drawn shade, morning, the clothes flattened with our hands, the suitcase zipped, a short walk to the stone house, to the oak trees, the stables where the Lipizzaner stallions were kept, where the riders pushed the horses to perfection in straightness, contact, and impulsion. And in their dark compartments, the young, the celebrated, were changing from gray to white. The other two poems I'll read are in the current issue. It's a beautiful issue. I'm sure many of you have had a chance to see it, and I'm really honored to be included in its pages. The first poem is called Linen, another poem of travel about a pilgrimage site in the Dordogne, an abbey called Carouin. Linen. In my room, there are flowers wrapped in newspaper. Hotels are places of sadness. Outside, the grass scorched by the sun, but the pool is so cold. It's the end of summer, but the weather changes. Another season enters it. The monastery I visit is where pilgrims came to see the face cloth of Christ. It never really wrapped his head. Dusk comes suddenly, gold on the edges of clouds. In 1791, they arrested the monks and set their books on fire. I will be young for many years. I wear a sweater by the pool. And I'll conclude with a short love poem. Things that are rare. It is so easy to imagine your absence. Maybe it is night. We are still handsome. All the young are. It is so easy. Another thing to be beautiful. How gently the curtain falls back down and the room is dark again. The season of in-betweenities, my eyes heavy, my lips numb. Fingerprints on the unjacketed books, inside the collars of the shirts in the open closet. An affluent night. You've touched everything in my small room.
Thank you so much, Richie. It's so good to hear you sing those poems. Our next reader is Rajiv Mohabir, selected by Brenda Shaughnessy for the 2014 Intro Prize in Poetry by Four Way Books for his book entitled The Taxidermist Cut. Rajiv Mohabir's first collection is a finalist for the 2017 Lambda Literary Award in Gay Poetry. His second manuscript, The Cowherd's Son, won the 2015 Kundiman Prize. 2021 saw the release of Mohabir's poetry collection, Cutlish, by Four Way Books. He was also awarded the Harold Morton Landon Translation Award from the Academy of American Poets and a 2015 Pennheim Translation Fund Grant for his translation of La La Bihari Sharma's I Even Regret Night, Holy Songs of Demerara. In 2019, Mohabir also received the New Immigrant Writing Award from Restless Books for his memoir, Antiman, selected by Terry Hong, Hector Tobar, and Ilian Stavins. He teaches in Emerson College. Please welcome Rajiv Mohabir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, okay, you can hear me. Thank you so much, Nicole, my goodness. And everyone who's arranged this and then to read with you, Richie, and you know, Linda, it's also like so wonderful to be here and sharing space. I'm gonna read three short poems for you tonight. The first one is from the book Cutlish, and it's called Guide. And it's based on the 1965 film called Guide, based on the R.K. Narayan book, Guide. it's starring Devanand and Wahida Rahman, who are actors here. And the thing that you need to know about Guide in this poem is that the names Ram and Rahim are two different names for the divine. Ram being an incarnation of Vishnu, and Rahim being one of the epithets of Allah. So Guide. In the desert, if I say Ram or Rahim, will the clouds break into a steady drum? If sky cracks, I will sing for you, stamp my feet into ribbon. What if I said, even in the night, where your hair's perfume torments that I am still parched? There are no lowly births. Clouds too begin first as sea. Would you believe that I could leave the world drawn up by the sun as a saint? Me, a sham of a man. I watched you dance like a cobra. What does it take to be so bewitched by spirit? I spend the dark with whiskey, making a mask of withered roses. How quickly a shadow can pass and you become a stranger. And so for the next poem that I'm gonna read, this is in the September-October issue of Kenyan Review. It's called Ode to Wahida Rahman's Serpent Dance. And I maybe am obsessed with this movie more than I should be, but you know, one of the things that I really loved about this movie was the different ways that people lost themselves to spirit and to the divine. And as that's something that I'm currently thinking through, it's also something that I'm gonna end with, something really raw tonight. But this is my middle poem and it is in this gorgeous issue. Ode to Wahida Rahman's Serpent Dance. A double-barrel bina flute, greened and hollowed, purrs in front of fangs. The hood extends from a grass basket. I don't watch any man's monkey stare, my whole body beat and drum. There is no lord, only twisting. Naga, cobra, enter me until I am Eve feared. My sari's end I tuck into my waist, my ankle bells silver ringing rivers. My knees I scrape bare into dusty scales. Naga, take this sweat gift until I no longer shine, until my green gloss turns gold. This whirl until my feet no longer fount and flicker, until these arms contort as coils, until these tendrils escape my braid into new wilderness, wild reeds on the bank, to be hewn into flute. So this is, you know, something that I've been following here in the pandemic, and it's been really hard for me to sit in front of a computer any more than I have to. And so I've been giving myself these like quick little writing exercises where I'm taking 100 poems of Kabir that have been translated in the early 1900s by Rabindranath Tagore. And, you know, Tagore's translations were good for when they were. And what I really love about these translations, this is a facsimile of a copy from the 1900s, is that, you know, he has this like transliteration of the actual dohas and the songs of Kabir in the book. And I'm taking the title and I'm not translating it, and I'm using them to title my own poems. So I'm going to read to you tonight a poem that I've been working on this week, and it's really raw. And I know that there are a lot of students in this Zoom meeting, and this is my offering to you to show you something very much in process. But you know what? I will translate the title for you just because, you know, it's a reading and it'll be fun. So this one is called Tirat Mein To Sab Pani Hai, which means at the place of pilgrimage, there is only water. Consider the marigold, beloved of the elephant-headed god, strung into a garland I wore to my wedding. It's gold, scentless. A bee has no reason to stick itself to saffron. I'm not telling you anything the dawn and dusk haven't plucked on the lyre of epics. Named for Mary's gold, the king of heaven was gifted myrrh. Marigold, its name senseless. At the holy places, Kabir says, there is only water. Can a river be anything but itself, emptying into a greater body? But I make this sexual. What is my body if not its own river, if not its own marigold? Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. All three of you. Now we're in the talking mode, in the question and the conversation mode. And then I know that there will be time for all of us to ask questions and to be an even larger conversation. But let me just start by first saying, you know, right now for us at the Review, we're looking at so many manuscripts. You know, we got like 10,000 manuscripts this year, which is amazing. And it's so wonderful. And then, you know, from all of those, we found your voices. And I will say, for me, one of the joys is kind of as the issue starts to assemble itself and pull together, to recognize the symmetries and kind of the resonances between the voices. And I think, like, I'm so pleased that you all agreed to do this reading, because I think that you're all working in ways that I had previously thought was really different, like really different kind of trajectories and worlds of thought. And then as I looked at the work and as I read your interviews and as I thought about all of these poems, I realized it's a smaller world that contains all three of you, you know, which was so wonderful to see. So thank you for agreeing. Thank you for giving us the privilege of publishing the work. And then for getting on the Zoom. I know, Rajiv, I think no one wants to be in the Zoom more than they have to, but thank you so much for getting on the Zoom to be in conversation today. I really appreciate it. So if I can start with the first question for you all, I'm very, very curious to know which books were the ones that sort of raised you in poetry and shaped your notion of what was possible, or reshaped your notion of what was possible. Which are the books that, or possibly the teachers that that brought you forward and into your practice and your writing career? Can I start with Richie? Can I just call on you?
Sure. Well, I growing up, I loved singing. I think I became interested in poetry through song. I was a chorister and I did musical theater and I loved Sondheim. So it's been a kind of week of mourning him, but also getting to kind of live again inside those marvelous shows. And when I got to college, poets I loved were Cavafy and Hart Crane, who kind of opened up new worlds to me. In terms of, you know, more recent books and teachers, my first poetry workshop in grad school was with Natasha Trethewey, and her book Native Guard had recently come out. It's one of my favorite books. I teach it like every possible chance I get. I think it's just so stunning. And I think I gained from Natasha, among other things, a kind of real interest in poems that use form as part of their argument, as part of their critique. That's something that Native Guard does so well, and her other books for that matter. And in the workshop too, I loved the emphasis was on clarity. And you know what it's like being in a workshop, many of you, you know, it's it can be kind of frustrating at times as you're coming up in poetry and trying to define your values. But the best workshops for me are the ones where the instructor has a real point of view, something to kind of work toward, but also against. And Natasha's love of clarity and our focus on clarity and narrative, I think really shaped my writing. It's something I'm still thinking about every time I sit down and work on a new draft. And I think about it even more leading my own workshops and working with my own students. So the values of those books and of those encounters in the classroom are always with me.
Yeah, Natasha is also, she is so exquisitely rigorous with the precision also. Just she's an incredible teacher. How about for you, Linda?
You know, I'm always flummoxed by this question because I read some of the reading, much of the reading that matters most to me is not work that I would ever either presume to sort of imitate or that is historically and sometimes culturally, ideologically very, very distant and really useful to me for that reason. I think the first poet I encountered whose voice gave me a sense of what the first contemporary poet of what sort of thinking, what movement of mind in process might be like in a poem was Robert Hess. And you know, it was his second book, it was Praise. And it was just that book meant a huge amount to a lot of people of my generation. And it just opened up a lot of possibilities. It was alive to all the intellectual ferment, sort of all the new thinking coming across from France and getting, you know, repackaged at Yale and so forth. But it was also irreverent toward that and toward intellection, which I think is another mark of taking the passions of the mind very, very seriously. I will say, and I should, God knows I read tons and tons of women, and actually Kathleen Graber is a poet I deeply admire and never tire of reading. I've learned so much about her, although so much from her. But a lot of the poets who've been, in the past few years, I find really mattering to me are Ross Gay, Jericho Brown, Shane McRae. I've taught in the language of my captor lots of times, and I sometimes wish certain parts of that book had been changed, but the middle sequence is just the Jim Limber sequence to me is just transcendently brilliant. It's moving, it's smart, it's profound about history, and it finds a way of lodging historical consciousness in the deeply paradoxical circumstances of a single mind. It is, it's incredibly compassionate and complex. And you know, Ross is just, can be just spectacularly gorgeous. And I've tried to my, probably I've fallen flat on my face trying to write poems in his mode occasionally, but he does lead me to things. And sometimes I think, you know, doing an imitation that's bound to be a disaster can actually be a way to sort of find something new, not to keep necessarily as an imitation.
Thank you, Linda. Rajiv, how about you?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for this question as well. And like, as I've been thinking about how to answer this for our evening tonight, you know, I'm like racking my brain. And I'm just going to be like, you know, actually, so this was the first poet that I ever knew. This is my Aji, my grandmother, who was unlettered in the two languages that she spoke, which were Bhojpuri and Guyanese Creole. And so I came to poetry through her song. You know, she was singing in this language that I didn't grow up speaking, that I learned later on. And it was through the act of translating these songs that I realized that, you know, what was magical about them was like this, you know, her ability to sit down and sing the epics, like in the Indian epics from, you know, beginning to end in this other kind of otherworldly way, whether it was, you know, quoting, you know, the bhakti devotional poets, the Tulsidas that she'd only ever heard, or if it were through like wedding house songs where, you know, women would get together and sing in the folk tradition and the men would be together in the, you know, listening to the Sanskrit, which was, you know, this reified, deified language. And so for me, it was really my draw, I was drawn to poetry through folk culture and through the translation aspect of growing up in the United States. I think when I started to realize what I was doing, like, you know, oh, this, you know, translation is the thing that, or poetry is the thing that I've been obsessed with, is when I was an undergrad, I realized that, you know, I was a religious studies major, and I was reading all of these like sacred texts from South Asia, whether it was, you know, and I really love the devotional poets. So this return to Kabir is very much a return for me to like a what feels like a home space, because it's, yes, this book is important, but I've also been listening to the music that has been attached to the Kabir Panthis, the Kabir tradition of Pandit Chanulal Mishra, for example. And he's somebody that I really love. You know, there's a really wonderful project called the Kabir Project, you know, Kabir was somebody who was against caste. He was against religious distinctions in religion. And I, as somebody being Caribbean and Indian, it was important to me. This kind of philosophy was always important to me. And when I started to, you know, shift into the page and to think about, oh, okay, well, oh, poetry is a thing that I could do. I never really thought that, you know, it was a thing that, I don't come from a very literate family, let's just say. And so, you know, when I did realize that there were people who were writing in Guyanese Creole, you know, David Dabitin, Chinnapen is another person, Ruplal Monar and Mahadev Das, who are, you know, these like giants in the Caribbean literary world, that I realized, oh my God, there is space for me, but like, what does it mean to be in the United States? So then I started being drawn to folks who take oral tradition and put it onto paper. So one of my first, poetry rabbit holes was Joy Harjo. We Became Human was the first, you know, volume that I've really dog-eared, and I've followed her. I've read her backwards and forwards. I've gone to, like, you know, from the beginning to the end and back to the beginning, you know. And then I also did that with Agha Shahid Ali, who, you know, I was exposed to actually first through his translation of Fez, Ahmed Fez, you know, these beautiful ghazals that were, you know, again, linked to a musical performative tradition that I knew so in this kind of like bodily way before encountering the spacing and the alignments on page. And it was really lovely to work through that and to, you know, be completely arrested by, you know, his posthumous collection of ghazals called Call Me Ishmael Tonight, which, you know, really changed the way that I interfaced with, you know, the world of writing. And I think like these are, you know, this is like roots. I mean, I'll be remiss if I don't mention Mirabai as well, you know. The big distinction here is like Mirabai is, you know, the devotional poet who sings of the God that has attributes. Kabir is the devotional poet who sings of the God without attributes. And so, you know, what does it mean for me to like kind of merge these together or to be a complete atheist, but to have like spiritual feelings anyway, that feel ancestral. So then what is atheism for me? I don't know. But anyway, here's like a big word soup of my influences and where I've been.
Such a good word soup. I feel also like I wish that I could see just all of the names that all three of you just mentioned, just a long list that, you know, we need the study sheet so we can get into it too. I guess my question for you now, all three of you are in really different moments in your career, but also kind of in a different moment of productivity. So now that we have heard a little bit about the roots and kind of these, the places that have brought you, especially from early beginnings, I'm really curious, what is happening with the work right now in this moment? Linda, I know you have a book coming out. Richie, I know your book is about to come out. Rajiv, you just have been hugely, hugely productive in the past couple of years and have two books come out this year, right? So I just have to feel that this leaves you in a really particular space creatively. And I'm curious to hear about that. And I can imagine this is all sort of compounded by, you know, by this other weird, larger moment that we're all participating in just with the pandemic and the endlessness and the way that our lives have been upended and transformed. So I'm wondering if you can talk to me a little bit about the work right now and how you're feeling and how you're working through. I know, you know, in relationship to these larger projects that you've been engaging for a long time. Linda, should I start with you?
Sure, although do you mind if I piggyback a little bit onto what Rajiv was talking about first, because I'm so thrilled you brought up Shahid, Rajiv. I often teach Shahid's work because I think he does a really astonishing thing that is so urgent for our time, which is to say, insists. He's writing about both a cultural site, a religion, Shiite Islam, about familial tradition, about a country that has been deprived of its ability to be an independent country, Kashmir, and about exile in a, you know, way. I mean, he was doing this decades ago, but he's so deft and generous at including the audience he knows to be uninitiated in all of that. He was living, working in America. He was in many ways addressing an English-speaking audience and one quite ignorant of the histories and the forms of faith and observance he was talking about. And he's just extraordinary, because what he does is invite us in. We're not made sort of ethnographers or something, nor are we in a hostile way reprimanded for our ignorance. Where he reiterates and makes explicit, and then turns into recurrent song, enough of what matters to him that we begin to feel as though we are recognizing rather than encountering for the first time. It's a skill I just think so many of us could benefit from in this time, because it's properly a time of, you know, poetry worldwide, but let's just say in the United States, opening to so many different voices and traditions and backgrounds. And the question is how a reader is invited into that. And so I just Thank you for mentioning him, that's all. I'll stop for a while. I'm happy to go about process, but I don't want to take up too much of your time.
I would love for you to take up our time, Linda. I could listen to you talk all day, but I am still really curious. Just I have the personal experience of reaching the end of a project, and there's a lot of sadness in that, you know.
There is.
And so I'm just curious, you know, what is fueling you? What are you thinking about? How are you moving forward? And what's next for you?
Well, I also, I'm often at a loss when I've finished a book of poems, and partly because I'm always overcommitted to 10,000 other things, or, you know, I have prose projects I'm doing as well and stuff. But I also, this book was finished, I had an enormous luxury of time because I actually had a fellowship leave during last year, the 2021 academic year. And it's a pandemic. We were perforce home. I wasn't able to travel in the way I normally do. Usually my husband and I are out of the country for several months of the year. And I just had this, it was wondrous. I mean, I rode my bike on our country roads, and I kind of worked on poems in my head, because I work very slowly. You know, it's got to be line by line, phrase by phrase, bit by bit. And, you know, my sort of 3 or 5 or 7 mile circuit would be sometimes just enough to problem solve the next little piece of the poem. And so I am rather bereft, frankly, at being thrown back into a very different kind of busyness. I'm trying to write, as it were, kind of sufficient unto the moment, which doesn't mean I take it upon myself to write grandly about all the challenges facing humankind, but I'm suddenly very impatient with a lot of my own inwardness, frankly. I'm feeling as though anything that's a narrow point of view that's predicated on memory had really better be pretty urgent, or that's predicated on a moment of joy or despair of the moment. And so it's challenging now, because it feels like there are different scales of concern I want to be able to address, and I'm happiest when I'm able to commute among them, but that takes rejecting about 117 starting places before I find one that, you know, will have a little bit of traction. So I've written some new poems, and I'm very relieved about that, to not have the cupboard entirely bare, you know, when this book comes out. And I've got some others going on, and I can't tell yet whether they're part of a sequence I'm going to live with. They're a little different formally than what I normally do. They're stripped of the kind of stanza structure I usually rely on. And they're much simpler in formatting. And so I'm going to see how that works and what I'm thrown back on when I don't have the syncopation of those variable lineations and spacings.
Okay. So, you know, it's one of the things that that struck me as you all holding in common was that entry point and the invitation. And I think that you all have a way of being, you know, capacious, but also awake to the world. And you're really alert to the world. And I feel like the poems, even they're all the kind of poems that they seem like small rooms when you enter, and there's something deceptively simple in the prime numbers of the poem, but they all open up. And that is something that I found in common with all of you as I read through the work. And so I thought to myself, I was patting myself on the back. I was like, this is a great group of people who are all, you know, like harmonizing in the same kind of way. But okay, so you are a little bereft, but still making some new work and it seems like growing and working in some new directions. How about you, Richie?
It's so interesting to hear Linda talk about urgency, because in some ways I feel like I'm kind of craving sensuousness and intimacy, contact with something that feels physical and sensory after the year, mostly alone. It was really challenging for me to write that year, to make a space for it. Lots of anxiety, I think, like so many of us felt. Not anxiety, I mean, real fear, especially last fall, when the political situation just left no room, or seemed to leave no room. But I feel like since coming back to San Francisco and starting teaching again, I feel like I've kind of been reacquainted a bit with myself. And I really urged myself to start working. My book comes out in February, and I thought by the time that comes out, I'd like to be in the thick of something else, so I can feel ironically detached from it, in case people hate it, or if they like it, to kind of already have moved on. And I think I've been looking for a new music, like Linda was saying, but with her new different kind of reliance on stanza. My new book, it's all very short poems, like the two poems in the current issue. I kind of think of that book as a diary, as a kind of erotic journal. And so as I've been kind of returning to work, it's been about pushing past that, writing as long as I possibly can, playing with time in ways I'm not used to, juxtaposing time periods and memories in a way that kind of pushed past the kind of sensuous and brief kind of one night stand style poem, and to imagine something more capacious. I've been trying to do that since I've been back here. And it feels wonderful to grope forward poem by poem. That for me is the kind of the marvelous feeling. That's when I feel happiest, when I'm in the thick of something new. And it's not a book, and it doesn't have to be. It's just a kind of process of writing poems and sharing them with a couple friends. My advice for students is always to kind of listen for your poetry friends in class, if you're lucky to connect with someone, because last year and this year, but every year, I rely so much on those other writers to keep me going and to help me understand myself. It can be so difficult to see what it is you're trying to do, and to find people who are truly honest with you, but who treat you with kindness and love. That's the best gift. And I don't think I would do anything without those people.
Thank you, Richie. That's great advice. Rajiv, where are you at with the work?
Yeah, thank you for this question too, because it's so generous of a question in how it opens up so that we can like hold ourselves and see us for where we really truly are. I've been at a loss, actually, like at a loss so much, in fact, that like reading was really, really hard for me by summertime of this year, and then, you know, try telling that to a bunch of students in the fall, like, I'm having a hard time even tracking what I'm reading, and, you know, it's anxiety, but then fear, you know, as Richie was saying. And so I did a thing where I just took off the reins as I was starting to think through what is important to me. And, you know, it's, I shared a little bit about what I was doing right now, like the raw kind of return to Kabir. And I think that that's also kind of like a spiritual return, you know. You know, this year also saw my memoir come out, which is so much about my journey into poetry and about my grandmother, that I've been listening to songs that I used to listen to in my childhood. And actually, I've been really inspired by them, like, you know, these Bollywood songs in the 50s, 60s, you know, were not in Hindi, they were mostly in Urdu and Bhojpuri, which are, you know, in my opinion, you know, more, they're languages that are important to, let's say, the literary world of South Asia, but then to oral culture specifically. And I've been getting a lot of joy from that as well. And so trying to bring that into my daily practice has seen me start to open up. And so I'm reading more now, and I have, like, I'm really excited about my book pile that really hasn't actually done anything but grow since the pandemic, you know, returning to this and then thinking through form, like, you know, Cutlish, that has just come out, was so obsessed with the chutney poem form that, you know, trying to get out of that and to push beyond it, you know, Richie was saying, is something that I'm finding myself looking for. I'm wanting from these poems explosions, little tiny explosions. I want to be led in a place that's not, you know, that won't come about from anything but meditation. You know, I don't want the doors, I don't want to open the doors that I see from the beginning of the poem. I want those doors to just materialize all of a sudden, and I want to walk through them. And so that's kind of where I am with these Kabir poems, which feels kind of wrong to do, honestly, because it's, you know, taking these titles, it just feels like such a violent act. And, you know, I have, like, these feelings about Tagore that are, like, you know, anti-Hindu nationalist, and, you know, how he's, like, venerated as this, like, poet of the people in a way that was upper casted, and then also about nation building. I mean, you know, it was important once upon a time to build nation in India. But I think we're in a different place now, looking at, you know, what's happening with Kashmir, you know, even still today, what's happening with Kashmir. And so, like, how then do you write through these things? And, you know, Richie is, you know, that's something that I did as well. I have a poetry friend, and, you know, what we do is, he lives in New Zealand. And I, you know, we write to each other poems, like, based on, you know, Sanskrit prayers that I really dislike, but he really, like, has grown up with that poetry as, like, his own. Rishi Vyas is his name. He has a book of poems coming out in 2023. We actually did this chapbook together, Between Us, Not Half a Saint, which is part of this conversation, but, like, how this has been extending. What we are doing is we're trying to write an infinite ghazal. So he's doing a couplet, I'm doing a couplet, and this has kept me on my toes. And, like, if I don't do anything all day except write a couplet for this ghazal, well, then I've, like, woven a bit of fabric for myself. So I, like, remembering that kind of joy has been important for me. That, and, like, I mean, you'll see all over me, there's, like, I'm just not even gonna worry about it anymore, but all this dog hair. I have a husky, and the husky is blowing her coat. And dear God, I'm now becoming that person that's writing poems about my dog and, like, crying as I'm writing my dog poems, which feels like, you know, this is a different Rajiv, that's for sure. So.
Thank you for that. I'm looking at the time. Elizabeth, is it time now to open up to other questions? I want to leave room for everyone to participate in the conversation.
Yes, and I will remind the audience that you can ask questions in a couple of ways. You can type it in the chat. We have one in the chat right now that I'll start with. Or you can let us know you have a question, and then we will offer you the opportunity to unmute yourself and you know, turn on your camera and ask it yourself. So you have a few options here. But Rajiv, there's a question about your recommendation for a modern translation of Kabir.
Yeah, thank you for this question. There's so many translations of Kabir out there that are so upsetting and like rob the poetry and the music from the verses. I really love the Kabir Project, and that's somebody, and that's something that I've said earlier. Shabnam Virmani is the person who is in charge of it. It's an organization in Bangalore, and what they do is they go throughout South Asia collecting Kabira songs, in their performative tradition, and you know, doing all of the things, including publishing these like booklets of like Kabir in Pakistan, Kabir in Malwa, like all of the different iterations of Kabir. And those translations are just beautifully rendered, in my opinion. And this might be controversial, my kind of go-to Kabir translation is the Arvind Krishnamurthy translation from 2010, called Songs of Kabir. And what he does is the translations are not word for word, but this old idea of what translations are, but really what I would call transpositions, where he transposes Kabir from the 1500s to the present. And it's like, you know, it's right here. It's on the, yeah. It's really irreverent and beautiful, folky kind of thing, done by a master poet, Arvind Krishnamurthy. It's funny that he is known in the West and in the United States as a translator when he has this long and illustrious career as a poet. And he's from Allahabad as well. And so a Bhojpuriya who speaks Purbik, which is, it's always nice to find a poet who's working in and out of language groups that you feel kin and connection to.
Thank you. We have a KR associate on the screen with us. This is Stephanie Chang. And for those of you who don't know, we have 80 Kenyon Review associates. These are Kenyon College students who help us run the journal, basically. But Stephanie has a question.
I have a question for Richie. And I'm thinking a lot about the last poem he read, Sacred and Profane Love. So my question is, what is the secret to writing a good love poem?
Well, I don't know. If I did it properly, I would be able to stop doing it. But I can't ever get it right. And so I keep trying to do it again and again and again. And now I have a whole book, really, of love poems. I would say I love sensuous details in a poem that feel like they have emotional information inside them, that they can kind of be a touchstone to some world of thought or feeling. That really draws me to poetry, love poetry of others. But I have to keep working at it. I think it's inexhaustible. I mean, because love is, and it's, there's nothing we can really understand about it. I'm always trying to make sense of how the feeling takes hold and consumes everything.
Thank you, Richie. Ocean, do you have a question?
Yes, thank you so much for y'all's gorgeous reading. I have a question, I guess, especially for Linda. I want to ask, like, how, if at all, do you envision poetry as like a communal act, or like how has mentoring emerging writer, or especially directing the Helen Zell Writers Program, like shaped your experience in writing poetry?
Thank you for that wonderful question, Ocean. More broadly about the communal process. I mean, poetry isn't completed. I began, the first kind of creative work I did with seriousness in my life was working in the theater, was acting. And performance is so utterly a collaborative mode. There's no such thing, to the point that, of course, you're out of work if you don't have the other people you're working, you need. But I think about writing that way a lot as well. And I guess in terms of, you know, rhetorical address and the way meaning accrues, that is, it's not, it needs that vital, it needs the participation, it needs the sympathetic completion, really, of a reader. And to that extent, a poem, you know, at a certain point is really quite outside, out of the hands of the one who proposes it on the page. And I think that, you know, that paradox of public-private is really its life's blood. That is, we're, you know, if we are addressing forms of pain or philosophical questions or questions of faith, it's not because we're in the first instance theologians or physicians of the mind, but because the lyric poem is an opportunity for, in fact, exploring questions through a lens, through point of view. And I think it was Rajiv talking a few minutes ago about doors opening and not wanting to know in advance where they are. Poetry to me is a discovery process. That is, one is not working on a poem if it's actually mapped out. If you know where you're going fully, it's not going to be a poem. It's going to be a paraphrase of something. It may be a paraphrase of some infinitely exquisite revelation you've had, but it's not going to be a poem, which is sort of in the flesh discovery. And that's the part about, you know, writing that's always proposing itself as addressed to another, and is always at some level needy, you know, is always asking. And I suppose, you know, it connects to Richie's point about love poems as well. That is, it's never over because it's always that longing for contact is always so elusive. And even, you know, what does it mean to be achieved? It's a fleeting present tense. And so of course one has to keep doing it over and over and over again. Teaching is very dear to me and really thrilling to me. And I'm quite a believer in the workshop process, because I see, and I just had my last workshop of the semester earlier today. And there's this sort of terrible sadness that comes when I know we're not going to be gathering together weekly for these conversations. But I find myself and I see others again and again and again practicing, getting limber at the very skills that will become their own poems, our own poems, by responding to the poems of others and trying to lift into articulateness that which is just beyond what we can capture right now. And so I think the things we treasure, that actually being in the present tense and maybe feeling that, you know, not all of it will have escaped us by the time we die, is it's prompted, it's given up, it's a gift of others. And it's exercise, one way or another, takes place in the presence of others. And so thank you for that question. I mean, I think it was just brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. I will I'll remind the audience, you have one more chance to ask questions, but in the interim, I know Stephanie has another one she'd like to ask.
So my last question is to Rajiv. And in an interview, you said, to be a queer immigrant of color is to be at one with the paradoxes around you. You choose to write into these paradoxes to see what kind of tensions emerge. So my question is, Do you think writing within these paradoxes kind of begets a new kind of language in your poems?
Oh man, wow. Thank you so much, Stephanie, for that question. And I think I was talking about genre when I said that, specifically. And then I also think that the paradox is something that, as a queer immigrant of color, and definitely in my community, is something that I've had to live through and survive in the different places and spaces in this hostile, racist country, that I find myself in. And I think that like the act of translation is also part of that. There's never a full rendering that makes sense or that is as beautiful in one language to the next. And so it's kind of like with these half-truths that I also find, that idea of what a poem can do and express. It's that thing just out of reach, as Linda was saying. And I see this also as, something that's quite divine. And I say that as like, I also claim to be an atheist, but it's something that I believe in so strongly. And here's another paradox I'm just holding. Well, there's a Hindu god of paradox, which is also something too, that I draw from to work through this. And I think that it's the question of genre that is usually the one that I find myself wrestling with. What is experimental? Isn't every poem an experiment? Isn't every like piece of writing an experiment? At least for me, that's how I see it. But then what does it mean for me to also transgress poems into the prose and transgress prose into poems when these like divisions are not part of like the literature that, or storytelling that I grew up in, where these all sidled together and, they were each other's river valleys that they would flood. The ground in between would always be fertile. So for me, it's, where does the story live? Rigoberto Gonzalez has this, he said this thing, wonderful thing to me. He said, sometimes a poem, a story is too big for a poem. And I was like, huh. I mean, because it really tripped me up because I was like, oh yeah, that's right. But then like, I was like, my poems aren't stories. And then he was like, aha, you get it. And I was like, yeah, okay. I see what you're doing here. So, I mean, the question then is what to convey and how to convey what to whom. I saw this as I was studying in Hawaii, which is a nation that is occupied illegally by the United States government, how the poetry that proliferates there and that is important is urgent in the ways that it disseminates information. There's like a literalness that is part of its art, and in which like there is kauna, or the hidden meaning for other folks to relate to. And so it's this kind of thing, like fitting so heinously, or trying to fit heinously into these boxes that are all around, of what a good immigrant should be, of what a good queer should be, what a good gay should be, what a good, X, Y, or Z, you name it. And I think that like, yeah, poetry allows me to blend that all together, extend it, and then to also borrow language from, the different speech communities that I am part of. And so that then becomes my own interlanguage, because, it's easy to say some things aren't translatable, that's for sure. But then like, when it comes to, for example, the titles of these Kabir poems that I'm thinking through, well, what would I do if I did the translation thing and translated the title into English? It wouldn't have that hearkening back to this old kind of form, but it wouldn't have the present velocity of saying again that this language, the original language, actually is important. So it's this paradox, right? And then, yeah, we do create new language. I mean, that's, I think we're constantly in the midst of language creation. A student taught me a word just, this week, situationship, about this, like, strange kind of hinterland between relationship and, non-relationship. And I think that it's all around us and it has such incredible velocity.
Thank you. Ocean's going to ask the final question, which comes from the chat. So you can look at it in case you need it to read it
Yes. Rogers from the audience asks, I'm curious how each of you balance narrative purity with the immediateness of concision. So as Linda says, the poem remains an act of discovery.
I guess I can take a stab at it. It's just a really hard thing. For me, it's why I write. I write very, very, very slowly. And that's when I like am writing. I don't mean sort of the, you know, infinite dry spells between things, but it's about, and this actually relates back to Rajiv's last point too. I mean, I'm really liking this conversation because they're all, it's really weaving, but narrative is an issue in many, many, many lyric poems, which doesn't mean that storytelling per se, in the sense, you know, that plenitude of story is our main job, but often just to place a feeling or a sensuous moment or an image, it requires some summoning of context or place or sequence. And I find myself spending a lot of time leaving out. That's a cliche about poetry, that it's at least as much about what you leave out as what you put in. But then for me, it's actually very practical, because when I'm putting pieces together, I'm very aware of at any moment when it gets to be too muchness, I'm explaining too much or getting too predictable, that has to, and that's another thing about the collaborative nature of poetry, is that one has to leave something for the reader to do as well. It's not, we're not there to sort of fill up all the airspace and all the white space on the page. And so the most suggestiveness and suggestibility and precision with fewest gestures. And that, for me, it's about regulating its unfolding. I can't do it by writing a big, messy draft and then going back and refining it, because then I know at some level, but I can't maintain that necessary ignorance. There's a sense in which the poem then is never going to be able to forget what it came to, however much it clears itself of mess. So I have to not go farther than I can actually more or less nail it down, which means I write syllable by syllable, phrase by phrase, line by line, and keep that sort of cliff's edge of my own ignorance in front of me all the time, while I'm sort of cutting and eliminating and trying to discover the just formulation.
I love that phrase, the regulating, the unfolding. That's wonderful. Rajiv or Richie, did you have any comments to make around this notion of how to keep the stakes high for yourselves and keep it fresh and to keep yourself active in the poem and keep the energy there, the discovery there?
I often think about this notion of James Merrill's, that form is a divining rod for content, and that by following the forms that each poem sets, you're kind of led to new places of discovery. I'm often thinking about how can I relinquish some of my authority back to language itself, whether it's through the kind of push and pull of poems in lines, or through sonic patterns that you hear in the language. That's another way to kind of keep yourself in a place of openness to discovery is by letting the features of the poem, whether it's lineated, whether it rhymes, whether it has a certain kind of sonic terrain, kind of interest in leaping or juxtaposition, whatever kind of formal terrain you're dealing with, to give some of that authority or to honor the authority of the poem in making a lot of those decisions for you.
I love that too. And Rajiv, I mean, you're working in endless projects with someone in New Zealand, so I feel like you're always.
Yeah, I mean, so very, very briefly, I mean, I like the idea of form as well as, like, you know, that kind of way to free your mind. And then also, you know, the ways in which, I had a thought and then I lost it. But I mean, there's so many ways to do this. And for me, it's about, if I find that I need to walk away from a draft, then I need to just walk away from a draft. Whether it was, you know, whether the experiment was working well, this is such a hard thing to do because I think it's so different for each poem. You know, for me, in terms of what needs to be said, what is overheard by the reader when I'm addressing the daemon, right? That's the kind of thing that I need. Like, what is the absolute essential thing that needs to be said, and how much do we let the reader in? And that's something that I'm constantly struggling with personally, where, you know, I do that thing that you know, might be egregious, you know, to Linda for sure, of overwriting and then, you know, seeing the different pathways that the poem takes, and then committing and following one, or not committing and following five. And then at the end of that experimentation of, you know, a couple weeks, walking away from that draft, or like at least letting it into the drawer to sit, and maybe turn into kimchi, you know, and then that would be a beautiful surprise when I return to it with fresh eyes.
Thank you.
And it seems like it's time, right, Elizabeth?
It is time. And Nicole, thank you for imagining this grouping of people to come together into a room. And thank you, Linda, Rajiv and Richie, for saying yes and for showing up. Thank you, Ocean and Stephanie, for preparing for this and helping us run the whole thing. And thank you, audience, for being with us this whole time. You know, you all spoke about community being so very important, nurturing it. Linda and Rajiv and Richie, you mentioned, you know, specific people that you reach out to, and we are very grateful to have you in our KR community. So thank you. And everybody have a wonderful night.
Thank you. Thanks, Elizabeth. Thank you all.